Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks so much for coming to this event today. Today, we are joined by Stavros Lambrinidis. Stavros is the ambassador of the European Union to the United States and has been since 2019. Stavros is a Greek lawyer and politician. He started his career in 1994 in Greece by being a special advisor to the prime minister at the time. In 2011, he has also served as Minister of Foreign Affairs in Greece. He has worked more than 7 years as European Union Special Representative for Human Rights, where he visited numerous countries around the world and has worked tirelessly to advocate human rights. Thanks so much, and I'll now hand over to Stavros to tell us a bit more about himself.
Thank you, Rachel. Thank you very much. I have to confess, I feel a little robbed not being able to be there in person with you. And I understand that usually your events are quite formal, you know, in a very nice room and all these things. And but I promise next time, especially when I'm in Europe, close to the UK, to try to come and see you in person. You know, very often when I talk to students and others, frankly, I ask them to tell me what they plan to do next in their lives. And I find that it's usually quite easy, not super easy, but quite easy for them to tell me what they want to be or what maybe they would like to be. And then the second question that I ask is, well, how do you plan to do that? How do you plan to achieve what you say you want to achieve? And then a fewer number of people actually can give an answer to that, right? So the what, more or less, people can say something. The how, they have to think a little bit more about that. And then when they give me an answer to that, my third question, which to me is the fundamental question, is why? Why do you want to do and achieve what you say you want to achieve? And when it comes to talking to people in my life, when it comes to every professional personal relationship that I've had, the why is what makes it real or not. Because that's where you really reveal what motivates you, what kind of fire you have inside you. And I can absolutely guarantee that as you move on in your professional, academic, whatever other careers in your lives, the people you really want to work with will probably want to focus on your why. So don't just recite the resume, as Rachel did in my case. Thank you for that. But try to explain why. Now, I don't have too many minutes to speak to you openly, and I can tell you quite a bit about my life. But let me tell you, however, because Ukraine is the biggest issue that consumes me today as the European Union ambassador of the United States, and also the European Union more broadly. Let me tell you a little bit the why, the European Union's why when it comes to Ukraine. Why are we so massively imposing sanctions that we've never imposed on anyone else in the history of the EU? A very difficult process, by the way, because it's not just a single government's decision. 27 governments have to unanimously decide to impose those sanctions. Why is it that we decided for the first time in our history to finance the purchase of lethal weapons, defensive weapons, and send them immediately to Ukraine from our 27 member states to ensure that they can resist as violently as they have been up to now against the Russian brutality and the bombs and the planes and the tanks? And the answer is fundamentally because we as Europeans came out of this type of horror. We were created after the Second World War, and were created precisely so that in our region, we would never perpetrate such brutality ourselves again, and we would never allow anyone else to. And that commitment has resulted in the past 70 years plus into the creation of the most prosperous, most peaceful, open, free, democratic region in the world. And Mr. Putin is trying to kill that. He is killing every day innocent men and women in Ukraine. But he is, and he said this openly, fundamentally aiming to kill the international legal order that came out of the Second World War, the security structures that we have in place, which fundamentally say you may not invade anymore another country or threaten it with violence for whatever reason, and certainly not for no reason at all, as is the case now with Mr. Putin and Ukraine, other than your delusion of grandeur or your decision, your unilateral decision that Ukraine should not exist. International law and international cooperation is the second why of the European Union. If you are not going to be fighting, you have to have rules of the game, and they have to be respected by everyone. When the European Union focuses so, with such, passion and energy and financial, backing and political and diplomatic pressure on human rights around the world, it is because international law, the U.S. Charter, the U.N. Charter says that it is human dignity that has to be protected. That was again after the Second World War. It's international law that dictates what ought to be done to ensure that societies don't splinter apart because of violence, because of denial of rights for everyone on the basis that we don't like their color or their religion or their sexual orientation or anything else. And it is international law that, if not respected, if Mr. Putin wins, if he imposes his tearing up of international treaties in the world, if he imposes might is right, it is international law, the European Union's why, that is at existential stake. This is why we are fighting Mr. Putin. But as I close, and I'd be happy to answer some personal questions, by the way, if people have them, Rachel, very happy to do so. As I close, let me also say very quickly that in the European Union, Ukraine is not the only existential threat, or I should say Putin's aggression against it and against the international legal order. There are other threats that we have faced the past few years and we are facing today. And they have united us in every instance more than we were united before the crisis hit. And we have moved the needle forward to create a better and stronger European Union to address every one of these crises. COVID, still going on, but the challenges are huge. The world population is still not vaccinated to a large extent, especially in poorer countries. And it is our obligation to ensure that we don't just save our people, but that we save others as well. Because this is about saving human dignity and lives, indeed. But it is also about democracies being able to show, as we have always in the past, that we are the greatest providers of global public goods to the world. It's not autocracies who are trying to utilize COVID to send that message as well. Climate change. This is an existential threat for our times, but it's not just the planet we're trying to save, because frankly, the planet has existed for billions of years before humans were on it, and will probably exist for billions of years if humans were to disappear. It is humanity that we're trying to ensure does not gradually or rapidly deteriorate through everything from having to address the most massive effects of climate change that are cascading, to also avoiding the wars and the devastation that will come from fighting over scarce water resources, for example, and everything else. But also, we are fighting this because we have determined that if the European Union and our member states are, as they are today, at the forefront of cutting-edge innovation, new technologies, and the sustainability of our economies will grow faster than they ever have in the past, and our people will have jobs and security that they've never seen in the past. And this is why you see the EU having committed from the beginning so massively in this direction. My effort here in the United States is to ensure that we can convince our American friends to stay on this path too, both now and potentially in the future. And I would say finally, dear friends, I spoke about the economy a little bit, but let me talk about the values underlining There is, you know, we all used to seeing containers leaving different ports, including goods from the UK, from the EU, from the US, from other countries. And we see those goods on there and we see dollar signs or euro signs on them. What we do not see is that in those containers, we also put together with our goods our values. When we produce goods in the European Union, it is not through using slave labor. It is not through violating women's rights and forcing them to stay at home. It is not through polluting the environment. It is through allowing free and open competition in our open markets that allow for the best product to win. And as we put our values in those containers and export our values around the world, so do increasingly other countries, such as China, who are putting their values in their containers. And so when we're looking at international trade, we're not just simply looking at, indeed, the greatest boost in our economies that has happened in ever, because we managed to open through a rules-based system trade in the past decades to the world. But we're also looking at a battle of narratives. We're looking at stopping corruption that can infiltrate societies by others and make them unstable and really dangerous for us as well, not just for our goods exports, but for our security. And so, why? Because that's what the EU was built on. Because it is existential to us. Because we will fight. We will fight if we need to ensure that peace and prosperity and respect for rights becomes, again, the world norm. If it doesn't, then everyone with the bigger guns, whether it is in the European neighborhood or in Asia or anywhere else in the world, will apply their own law. And that is maybe their why. Maybe that is their hope. But we have to stop them. So, Rachel, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to give these quick opening remarks. And I'm, like I said, I'll be happy to touch on anything that you or the people with us would like to ask.
Thank you. Thanks, Stavros, for those opening remarks and telling us a bit more about yourself and the role you do. You mentioned the why a lot. So what I would like to ask is about your personal why and what has inspired you personally to get more involved in politics.
So I would say in my case, it's two things. And they're related. So the first one is that I was born and I was a young kid when in Greece there was actually a dictatorship. It's very difficult to imagine that a European country, let alone the cradle of democracy, would actually have a dictatorship, but it did between 1967 and 1974. And it was just absolutely shocking to the adults in the room, because I was a very young kid at the time, at least my adults, my parents, that this could ever possibly happen. And they became immediately engaged in the anti-dictatorship movement, both in Greece and in the rest of Europe and in the UK, for that matter. And I was there watching and listening. The second reason is that unfortunately, neither of them was alive in 74 when the dictatorship fell. They died very young. My father died from a heart attack. My mother died 4 years later from cancer. And I was in a comfortable family environment, but I didn't have a family anymore. And I moved into a boarding school in Greece. And it was the first time in my life that I actually was in a room with another, you know, eight boys, studying together. I mean, they were all usually coming from different parts of Greece on scholarship, really, really smart kids, but relatively poor at the time. They couldn't afford the education of my high school. And I was forced to understand what it means to live together with others, to be compassionate and to be empathetic. It's very easy in that situation to just become close to yourself and egotistical. In my case, that shocking experience opened me up to listen and understand what problems someone else had faced, where they came from. It entirely changed my life. It made me decide to dedicate my life exactly to that, not to trying to promote what I thought was my self-interest immediately, but in fact, to find great fulfillment from focusing on the needs of others, especially others who were in a worse position than I was. And that's what also led me eventually to human rights.
So you've spoken a bit about your journey, Stavros. Is there any advice you would give to people who want to go down the same career path as you and are looking to get more involved in human rights and international diplomacy?
Oh, certainly, absolutely. I mean, look, even if you don't feel it burning in your heart, I absolutely encourage you to take some time to work with organizations or governments in the areas of human rights and democracy. And I encourage you because, first of all, the personal fulfillment you will probably find mixed in with the frustration of having to deal with problems that sometimes are very difficult to solve. But the personal fulfillment of trying to be empathetic and to understand is going to be unmatched. But I also think that your diplomatic skills and your political skills, if that's what interests you, will be honed to the extreme, because you will realize that you also have to remarkably try to understand what is in the mind, what motivates, what is the why of the oppressor. Because in many instances, to bring change, that has to come from within. We many times think we're just going to go and plant an American, a European, maybe a UK flag somewhere and tell people, you know, hail us, here we are. We're the human rights, you know, democracy people. And suddenly the whole country will just fall in line. But that's not the way it works. So we have to pressure repressive leaders, and we have to find the buttons that can most effectively exercise that pressure, their buttons. We have to understand where they come from. If they are occupied by irrational fears for their position, then we have to be able to address that too. But one way or the other, it's a remarkable diplomatic and political school to engage in those issues too. So you don't have to dedicate your life to politics or to human rights. Absolutely, if you want to see what your why is in the end, try to be for a while in a place that forces you to think of others, not just your immediate anxieties, needs, or self.
Definitely. I think I agree with you that it's really important to, you know, make sure your priorities and others in jobs such as this. One of the issues you mentioned in your opening remarks was climate change and how we need to see this as a crisis for humanity. Do you consider yourself to be optimistic in our efforts now that we're taking the issue seriously? And what do you think needs to be done in terms of international cooperation to make these attempts successful?
Well, yeah, I mean, so the cliche answer is I'm neither optimistic nor pessimistic. I'm realistic, blah, blah, blah. But frankly, I mean, I don't like those answers, although they're good. I mean, I suppose had I come up with it myself, I would think it's great. But look, I don't want to evade this. I am very cautiously optimistic, and I'm optimistic because we are catching this, and we're catching an international attention and commitment around it right at the time that it's about to fall off the scale, to become almost irreversible. And already, if you look at what the UN issued a couple of days ago, you will see that in some effects of climate change, even if we keep the temperature at 1.5 degrees beyond what we used to have, in some instances, there is the effects that we are facing now are in fact not reversible, but they will not be catastrophic because all the other stuff can be stopped and can be reversed. But it requires, as you said, I would say an individual commitment and an international commitment. And both those things have to happen at the same time. The moment I turn the light off in my living room when I'm not there, I am making an individual commitment, a huge individual commitment to energy efficiency. And to produce energy in our societies, we are burning a tremendous amount of fossil fuel. So individual responsibility, our ability to do the simple thing, multiplied by billions of people, automatically can make a difference. At the same time, so that's the micro level, right? Now you come to the national level, in this case, the European level. Some of us have to show leadership. Some of us have to be in front. Some of us have to convince others who are more reluctant or poorer and they're not sure how they can move to climate adaptation, that we are willing to both pay the cost but also reap the benefits, the obvious benefits of doing this now as opposed to not doing it. And this is what the European Union has decided to do years ago, together with the United States, the UK, at the Paris agreements. When the US left under former President Trump, that was one of the biggest disasters in the effort to stop climate. And when it returned now under President Biden, that was one of the most important diplomatic and political game changers. But at the same time, and we saw COP26 in Glasgow, we see that while we are getting more commitments from countries that a few years ago were reluctant to even acknowledge that climate change was an issue, we need to be able to support many countries around the world, including rich countries in some cases, but also poorer countries to make the transition, because they need the money. They need to mitigate for the effects of having to move initially to an energy that is much more expensive to them. And they need to mitigate for the fact that they may need to give up energy that they already have that is extremely polluting. So that commitment, the billions, trillions over a decade that we have made in Glasgow, now we are laser focused to ensure that we have the money to give to countries, not just give, but give in a concerted way, focused on investments that will make a difference. And then finally, we need the political commitment, not just the financial commitment of different countries, but we need the political commitment of the world around this initiative. Let me give you one example and close with this. Methane, you may have heard of methane emissions, some of you. Now, methane emissions, methane itself as a gas, is remarkable. It holds heat in the atmosphere when it is actually emitted itself. 80 times more heat than virtually any other, of the bad gases that we emit. If you manage to get rid of methane in the atmosphere, you automatically reduce the heat increase, the Celsius increase in the world. But is it that difficult to reduce methane emissions? The answer is no. It is probably one of the easiest things that we can do. It requires applying the technology that we have and requires a commitment by companies and by governments to make sure that we use it. We can tell where methane leaks from. It leaks from pipelines all the time. And we have the technology to detect where those leaks are and to fix them. It's not nuclear science here. And we also know that it leaks because many gas and oil producers flare, in other words, burn into the atmosphere the methane byproducts, or what they do, as opposed to containing them and stopping them, which actually costs more. But they can do it. The technology is there. So Americans and Europeans got together and launched a methane global pledge in Glasgow, and 110 countries in the world, there were only four at the beginning, have signed on to it. So now we're putting, teeth to that initiative to ensure that we can cut those emissions. You're asking me if I'm hopeful? You bet you I'm hopeful when we can have that political commitment backed by financial support, backed by actual things done.
Yeah, definitely. I see what you're saying about things getting done. But just as a follow-up question to this, how do you think EU regulations regarding carbon emissions can actually be enforced? And how can we hold some of these big companies accountable when they are going above what they should be expending in terms of emissions?
Well, our regulations in the EU are in place for many years. And of course, we're putting now more in place because we have a law in the EU that obligates us to move to carbon neutrality by 2050. It's not just an aspiration. We have passed it. The 27 EU member states and the European Parliament have passed it into law. So it is legally binding for us. And now the European Commission is coming out with all the regulation necessary to ensure that it can support that move to zero in 2050 and to more than 55% reductions by 2030. Those rules are very complicated. They have to do with the way that we are actually producing our goods, the things that we eat, agriculture. They have to do with the way that, indeed, as you said, our companies emit. It has to do with the ships and the planes that fly and what kind of costs, and incentives can be given to them, what kind of structure to ensure that they reduce their emissions. It has to do with major investment, European investment, in the new technologies that would get us there and in new European growth and jobs. And we are making this already up to now. So it's a very, very, very complex, holistic thing. But when it comes to companies, what we have in Europe already is what we call the emission trading system. Fundamentally, what that is, it's not a tax and it's not an incentive to companies. It's somewhere in between. It looks at the major manufacturing areas, in Europe, not geographic. I mean, in terms of the products they produce or they extract. And we have decided that they can emit up to a particular level of emissions, which is increasingly decreasing with time. If they don't, if they emit more, then they have to pay in the emissions trading system fund a very large amount of money for what they emit more. That fund automatically then gets used by a 27 member states to invest in new technologies that will make Europe greener and also to support companies who are meeting their goals. Or instead of paying that, our companies have the incentive of saying, okay, we will invest instead ourselves in creating those technologies that will make us emit less than our ceiling so that we don't pay anything in that fund, but we ourselves make a transformation. In the European Union, it has turned out that the emission trading system has massively increased the energy efficiency and the green of the biggest industries in Europe because they use that incentive. And then the question becomes, well, what about now, as we are making these huge investments, what about countries around the world who are not yet investing in this transition? Should they be able to bring in, a refrigerator that is built through emitting massively in their refrigerator factory and compete at lower prices, obviously, but effectively import also with that refrigerator the emissions, the carbon emissions that we have so hard tried to stop in Europe? Because if we allow that to happen, then they will continue producing by emitting. And then the question becomes, can we and should we, and our answer is yes, we can and we will, impose a tax on our borders that is like the emission trading system, telling different countries, you can invest now massively in reducing your emissions through new technologies or anything else, or if you don't, then your products will pay the equivalent of that tax that our companies have to pay. That has created another major incentive. So, you know what? Sometimes I hear that the EU is this regulatory, terrible superpower, right? All we do is regulate. You know, what nonsense. What we are doing here is, without a doubt, saving the planet while ensuring that innovation and free enterprise are booming in the process. And most important, as the EU, do not forget, Rachel and everyone else listening in to us, our how we did it in the EU was to take the 28 at the time with the UK set of regulations and laws, 28 separate set of regulations and laws that every one of our member states had, and get rid of them and replace them with one, the joint EU regulation that all member states agreed to. And that allowed us to break down borders for goods, for services, for capital, and importantly for people in the whole of the EU. That's how we became the biggest, open, most powerful, free market in the world of 450 million of the most prosperous consumers. This is why we are the biggest place where American companies today invest and make money from. This is why our companies are the biggest investors here in the United States, because we have created that economic strength by deregulating. We are the biggest deregulation experiment in the world. That's what the European Union is. And that is what our success has been.
Yeah, I think the success has been shown through, you know, the collaboration of the countries in the EU. But one of the recent, you know, quite recent events was the UK leaving the EU. What was your opinion on Brexit? And what do you think the greatest benefits and downsides are to being an EU member?
Oh, I don't. I can tell you from the member states of the EU that Brexit, of course, was a very, very unpleasant moment for us, for all of us. We didn't ask the UK to leave. We didn't want the UK to leave. A non-binding referendum in the UK was interpreted by the political forces at the time as an obligation to leave the EU. And it was also interpreted as an obligation to leave in a very particular way. So there were many different ways that UK would have left. It left in one of the hardest ways, creating the most problems for the UK. But the member states in the EU in the past few years, including after the Brexit, which was a crisis, have become even more united and stronger than before. I have been, relating and engaging with the United States in many different capacities and under very different hats for decades now, including having lived here and worked here and studied here in the United States. And I can tell you that there are people who always expect the EU somehow to collapse with every crisis. When the financial crisis hit, I was the foreign minister of Greece at the time. No one wanted to talk to me about the foreign policy of Greece. Who cares? Everyone wanted to ask me, okay, so when is Grexit going to happen? When is some other exit going to happen? When is the euro as a currency going to collapse? And in fact, although it was a very, very hard period for us, a real crisis in Europe, the euro is stronger today than it used to be back then. And not a single member state has left the EU because of that. And then the migration crisis hit. And there were people saying, okay, now this is the moment that Europe will have to collapse. And instead, we banded together. We ensured that we protect our borders. We ensured we applied human rights and all human rights that go to people seeking asylum. But we also made sure that we would not allow Europe to just be flooded by people. We will have a policy to ensure that people coming in Europe will be protected, will have a place in Europe, will be integrated, will not be outcasts. There will be no racism, which we punish through European laws, but also that we will support countries in Africa and elsewhere to get rid of the causes of that migration. We've invested massively since then, and European member states, again, poll Europeans today, after that crisis, they support the EU even more. And then, of course, you had the COVID crisis. And the COVID crisis was another proof that when Europe, the European Union, works together, as we did, it can procure faster and better vaccines than anyone else can, and pharmaceuticals and masks and everything else. We didn't allow our 27 member states to be, you know, flailing around the world trying to negotiate each individually, you know, give me a little vaccine here or give me a little mask there. We all pooled the power together, and from Brussels, we were able to get a massive order of masks out in no time that then we distributed to our member states. And of course, then we invested massively on the vaccines. You know, friends, now you can see from the flags behind me, as the ambassador of the European Union of the United States, I am especially proud that the first vaccine, the groundbreaking vaccine that changed our lives to the better and saved millions of lives and will save many more, was a vaccine that came out of a collaboration between the European Union and the United States. Pfizer, an American company, run, by the way, by a guy called Albert Bourla, who is Greek, and BioNTech, a German company, run by two German Turks, collaborated together on the massive groundbreaking technology and the massive groundbreaking production capacity that was put in place to be able to bring this vaccine out in record time, taking tremendous risks, but also taking support from the European Union. Now, that is a hopeful vision for the future, and that is where the EU is. Now, you asked about Brexit. Rachel, I don't know how much you want to delve into this, honestly, but look, like I said, we didn't ask for it. We didn't, you know, we were very sad when it happened. But now it's happened, and we want Brexit. Well, we want our relationship to succeed in the future. It requires building serious trust, and this trust has been undermined in the past year or two. I mean, before the ink on the signature on the Brexit agreement and the Northern Ireland Protocol could dry, we in the EU feel that the UK government decided to try to tear it up, and that is not okay, again, under international law. But we are deeply committed to finding ways to make this work. I hope, I really do hope, that the crisis with Russia today, that the fact that the UK and the European Union have been working so closely together on such an existential crisis, I hope that this will allow for different feelings to evolve about the EU and greater trust to be able to evolve on both sides. And if that happens, that may be one of the positive consequences of a terrible, terrible, violent tragedy that is unfolding right now in front of our eyes because of an authoritarian sitting on nuclear weapons trying to eliminate a free, open, independent country and trying to eliminate the international order that both the UK and the EU feel is existential.
On the topic of what's going on in Ukraine and Russia, I know you've kind of expressed that this is obviously a very bad situation, but do you think the EU should and could be doing more to help Ukraine? And in what way is this help being provided?
I don't, you know, people always ask that question. And to me, that question ignores the fact that we have provided more support, massive support to Ukraine, than it was even conceivable to anyone around the world in the past 2 weeks ago. Forget 2 days ago. We have hit Ukraine with three waves of massive economic sanctions, hitting its financial institutions and its central bank, hitting its oligarchs and all the economic system around Putin, and most important, although more long-term, depriving Ukraine of the Russia of the technology, the high advanced technology will need in order to move its economy to a modern direction in the future. We have at the same time committed lethal military aid as European Union and member states to Ukraine, immediately to the amount of 500 million euros. And this aid is today saving lives, or not saving all lives, I'm afraid, because Putin is bombing indiscriminately and killing innocent civilians, but it's allowing Ukrainians to fight and to resist. And that is what they asked us to do. And we did it immediately in an unprecedented way. And we also engaged in a massive diplomatic campaign around the world to isolate the international pariah that Putin has become from all his sources of political support or even economic support. Now, we will not be successful in every case there, but we are knocking on every door. We will hunt him down diplomatically as well to ensure that he cannot get away with this. And we hope, in the end of the day, that he will look at the cost and benefits, and he will decide that he will stop this violence, and he will find a diplomatic solution to which we also will be ready to support. So this really has been unprecedented. And let me say, it's unprecedented for the EU. But the fact that we did it together with the United States in such a coordinated manner, the fact that NATO, a collective defense umbrella, not only was not divided by Putin's threats and antics, but became more united than ever before. The fact that the EU-US relationship has moved to a point where there's a recognition of the EU's actual defense and security capabilities and role in the future, not just the economic ones. The fact that countries like Germany, immediately turned off the tap to Nord Stream 2, although that hurts them as well. That hurts them. The fact that France stopped exporting Airbus pieces that will probably end up grounding a big part of the Russian air industry in a few months' time, it hurts France too. The fact that we did all this, I think, is an indication to Putin and every Putin that you may think that the West democracies are weak, but maybe you've had a hard awakening. You may think that you can divide and conquer us. Think again. If that was your gamble, that failed. Now, if your gamble was to go and kill Ukrainians, that's going okay. That's going okay. A massive Russian army against a smaller Ukrainian army is invading. But the cost that Russia is facing today and the debilitating costs that it will be facing soon in the future certainly are now in the scales that Mr. Putin has to consider when it comes to cost and benefits of his brutality.
So Stavros, leading on from this, so you spent some time serving as the EU Special Representative for Human Rights. This invasion of Ukraine is what many would consider a clear violation of human rights. What do you think this says about our international regard for these rights and how we can improve that going forward?
I wouldn't confuse the two. So I will tell you that this invasion is unprecedented. It is something that we haven't seen since the Second World War. A country deciding unilaterally to invade another country with ground forces and try to take it over and to extinguish its independence, this we have never seen. Every single human right is violated here, but interestingly, the International Criminal Court yesterday announced that it will be beginning a proceeding to determine whether or not Putin is committing war crimes in this instance. So this is unique. When it comes to human rights themselves, there is very often also a might is right mentality behind the violators of rights. And we have to debunk this because they often try to, in different parts of the world, present this as a anti-Western also revolution. You know, it's easy in many parts of the world, in Africa, elsewhere, to try to justify any repression by saying, well, we're not going to listen to the West, the former colonizers, those who invaded here, did this bad thing, all that stuff, right? And what I always told people is, you know what? Human rights is not relative. It is the universal language of the powerless. In any culture, in any religion, in any political system, against the cultural relativism of the powerful, in that same religion, country, political system, you know, you will very rarely hear a woman being abused by her husband in any part of the world telling you, oh, please do not intervene on my behalf because human rights are not universal. It's okay for me to be beaten up, right? You will very often hear the husband doing the abusing or the government who does not have a law in place to criminalize it or the court or the policeman who refuses to arrest the abuser. You will hear them very often tell you, oh, you have no right to intervene. This is our own culture, our own society. Who are you to come in? Human rights are the universal language of the powerless against the cultural relativism of the powerful. And what I always often told people in different parts of the world where they didn't really share that immediate understanding, where they thought that, well, you know, we're a majority in here. You know, we don't like black people. We don't like gays. We don't like Greeks. Anything can come up. I would tell everyone, watch out, because we are all minorities. Even in this room that we're talking, we're all minorities. I may be in a majority right now in this virtual room. I cannot see everyone in here because, let's say, of my sex, I'm a male. Or I may be in a minority because of that. I don't know how many people. Let's say I'm a majority. At the same time that I'm a majority there, and I might say, okay, well, men rule, right? I'm majority, I can make a decision, it's democracy. The majority wins. So I want to impose those restrictions on all these women. At that same time, I am a minority at the same time. I am a minority because my religion is a minority religion. Maybe I'm a minority because I'm gay and in this room, you know, the majority is straight. Maybe I'm a minority because a thousand other reasons. The moment when you are in the majority and you decide, okay, now I can impose my will on those I don't like, that is the moment that you open the gates to hell, including against you, against yourself. We have to be able to fight for human rights relentlessly, but you also have to do it in a smart way, guys. Now, we know who the bad guys are in human rights. The Chinas, the Russias, we know the bad guys. Those who are committed to violating rights for ideological or political reasons. We know who the good guys are. Those who are committed for ideological or political reasons to protect human rights, even if we don't do it all the time perfectly. But we ignore, if we just focus on those two poles, the over 100 countries in the world that are sitting somewhere on the fence in the middle. They're not perfect democracies, but they're not ideologically determined to fight democracy. They are just not there. And maybe if you find a way to bring them into an alliance, to give them ownership of human rights, to make them feel that you're not telling them what to do, but that they're already owners, imperfect ones as it may be, then you have a chance to make sure that they fall on the right side of the fence. And that requires persistent, smart, relentless diplomatic work in addition to everything else.
Thanks so much, Stavros, for explaining this more to us. I know you mentioned that, you know, you spent a lot of time in Greece and have lived there before. I wanted to ask, in your opinion, what you think the most effective reforms are that have been made in Greece over the past few years?
I think the most effective reforms have been our decision to wean away from the dirty natural resources that actually we also have in Greece, lignite, which were cheap, and to invest massively in renewable energy. This has allowed for the Greek population, which is among the most highly educated in Europe, to be able to unfold all its innovation energies. And you see now a bunch of startups coming up, but also with major European Union help, we are investing massively in those new technologies. That's going to be big. I think a second thing that we have done is that we have gone through a very difficult political time after the financial crisis, where it was very, very difficult for many Greeks to understand how it was possible to have so many simple Greek citizens punished so much in order to be able to receive loans from our partners and go through so many years of misery. But at the same time, it was also difficult for many people to look at the flaws in Greece's economic political system. We have managed together through those changes in governments and through this constant process to be at a point now where we have the ownership and the future of our country firmly in our hands, together with our European Union partners. And that is actually creating hope for the future, no matter what political party you believe in, right? So I'm a politician. I come from a different political party from the one that is right now governing Greece, but that's not the point. The point is that Greece itself as a country has come out and is coming out stronger with all the issues and the problems. And the third thing that I would say that we have achieved as Greeks is that we managed very successfully to bring the European Union itself back to its fundamental founding principle of solidarity. And you see this solidarity unfolding in many of the recent crises. When the financial crisis hit, it was actually challenged. We're fighting among each other many times in Europe about who was good, who was bad, who deserved support, who didn't. And that, so changing Greece itself and changing things that needed to be changed in Greece and creating a narrative in Europe that, you know, strengthened the solidarity pillar of the European Union. I think these are the biggest successes of Greece in the past 10 years.
Thank you. Thanks, Stavros, for answering the questions that I've posed to you today. Before we end the event, I'll take one question from the audience, submit questions. So John has asked in the chat, what are the most crucial reforms that the European Union must pursue in the future?
Well, when I think about reforms, I think about something that is that needs to be radically changed. And I would tell you that I don't think that at this stage, these are the reforms we need, because we have made already the fundamental reforms needed politically and legally for the next 30, 40 years, moving Europe to a green economy, moving Europe to a tech revolution so that Europe can have technology sovereignty. This is the investment now through a collective new commitment, laws, regulations that we will have to focus on and make. So I would certainly focus on that. I would ensure that Europe becomes in the defense and security field stronger and more united. Today, European Union countries spend are the second biggest spenders on defense after the United States. But the problem is not the money we put in this only, it's the efficiency of their use. And we have realized in Europe that a lot of that money gets wasted on purchasing 17 different types of tanks and armored vehicles, when in fact we could develop together as Europeans with our capacities, one, the biggest, the best tank there is, for example. So that is what I think you will see increasingly happening in Europe, strengthening European collective defense through much closer collaboration of our member states that will automatically strengthen NATO as well. And for us, if anything, the Russia crisis indicated that this is existential and that we have not a day to lose in terms of being able to face that and any other aggressor in the future more effectively. We can do it now. We can do it now, but it's going to be just tremendously more effective and efficient and devastating as we develop as Europeans our defense capabilities. So let me leave it as that. There are many more other things, but let me leave it at that.
Thanks so much for offering us an insight into your roles with the EU, with Greece, and with human rights, and telling us a bit more about your opinions on some of the incredible crises that are facing us as humanity today. I'd like to thank everyone watching this event today, and thank you all for joining and listening to this incredible event. Thank you so much, Stavros. It's been a pleasure having you here at the Oxford Union.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye to everyone.